Philosophical questions. If a tree falls and no one is around to hear it, does it make a sound? If light breaks over the horizon but no one was awake to see it, does the sun actually rise? Dig this. If racism is happening, but there are no racists around to claim it, does oppression still occur? The answer is yes. Asterisks unless. Unless you can assemble a jury to say something different. Unless you can prove that you were just following protocol. Unless you can persuade the public that the deceased was a degenerate. If you can validate a fallacy, fabricating full sentences to the antithesis of freedom. If you can weave common belief into string strong enough to hold a body. If you can make a noose with enough leverage to uphold the weight of your innocence, then your insolence can be forgiven. Philosophical questions. If a black body falls and all lives matter, why is there never justice for the victim? See, if you don't see color, can't you differentiate shade? Can't you tell that they're black, that the judge, jury, and shooter are all the same shade, that the hoods are all the same, that everybody is watching, while the value of a black body hangs in the balance? But see, I get it. You're not racist. You're not a part of this problem, right? You're just bystanding. And as long as you can plead your case face to face with sound logic, logically deflecting, defending your position with enough ammunition, you can defeat your opposition. And I'm like, damn, it must be nice to have time to explain yourself. It must be nice to be living during your trial. It must be nice to believe that racism is dead because it's not knocking at your front door. What if we admitted that racism was still living? That hoods and nooses became segregation for school kids, became redlining agreements, became Tuskegee experiments, became war on drugs and jail time, became school to prison pipeline, became prison industrial complex, became slavery's new context, became Trayvon Martin, which became ironic because see, he became iconic for not living to see his 18th birthday. So he was deemed suspicious for wearing a hood in his hood while the neighborhood watched him lay lifeless. How do you explain what life is to a young black boy constantly watching himself lynched on the 7 o'clock news? How do you break the news that they tried to give him a noose? That there is no reprieve if a public servant can trade his life and for paid administrative leave? See, racism did not leave. It evolved. And tonight, it'll become the comments that flood this video on Facebook while the value of black bodies are still hanging in the balance, while the value of my black body still hangs in the balance. Why is it that black bodies never seem to find balance? What is balance? When you're the only black boy in the classroom, the only black body in the boardroom, the only black face at a police stop, the only soul that has slavery running through its bloodlines, this is what it feels like to be taught history that doesn't involve you. To be silenced into subordinates, to put your hands up and surrender and still get gunned down. This is what it feels like when they've sold your bloodlines, when your body has been reduced to the cost of ammunition. Pay attention. This is the same old story with the same old rope, just a new day, just a new stage, just a new hashtag, just a new grave, with just the same saying. If only he complied. But if only we realized, America, that you can't socialize people to be strong and criminalize them for standing if they've done nothing wrong. Philosophical question. When will it be publicly acceptable to claim that my life matters? That our lives matter? That these black lives, these black bodies, these black souls matter? Because see, racism is living. Well, hundreds of black bodies last year alone are not. But don't be mad at statistics if you're the one tying the knot. And don't be mad that I said that if you tend to sit and watch, you're content with what you're saying. I'm angry at what you're not. You say racism is interpersonal and just happens sporadically. I say racism is institutional and happens systematically. But you excuse yourself from the problem like it'll go away magically. But see, it lives in your silence and manifests in my tragedies. See, racism no longer needs racists to exist. It needs well-meaning people to sound like this, to be silent, to claim audience, to be bystander, while the value of black bodies are still hanging in the balance. Philosophical question. If you are silent in the face of injustice, are you standing on the side of the oppressor? The answer is always yes.
Wow. Thank you, Christian, for such a powerful kickoff to our 2020 Cradle to Career Network Convening. Your piece, Philosophical Questions, is a reminder to all of us that racism is systemic. It's built into the founding of our country, our communities, and our organizations. It has persisted and evolved throughout history, a history that's captured in the 1619 Project, which we'll get to dig deeper into next Friday with Nicole Hannah-Jones. But it's also a reminder that the onus is on us, that so many of us have been complicit in the perpetuation of systemic racism. Christian first performed Philosophical Questions in 2016, but it could have been written today as the nation demands action following the deaths of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and so many other Black men and women. The onus is on us to disrupt systemic racism, to be anti-racist, to demand change. And we have the power to create change. You have the power to create change. Over the next week, we will celebrate, explore, and strengthen the power you each have to build a better future. My name is Jennifer Blatz, and I'm the CEO of StriveTogether, and I want to officially welcome you to our 11th annual Cradle to Career Network Convening and our first ever virtual event. We have been coming together for nearly a decade. Our first convening in 2011 brought together 10 communities interested in creating a new methodology for cross-sector collaboration called Collective Impact. And this year, 65 partnerships will come together to explore how the collective movements that we have formed can be used to design new, equitable systems that ensure that every child succeeds. We welcome 4 new partnerships to the network this year: Delta Health Alliance, Cradle to Career Sonoma, On Track Washington County, and the Greater Dalton Education Partnership. And we welcome those of you attending your very first StriveTogether convening. We of course wish that we could all be together in Chicago this week. Today instead, I join you from our StriveTogether offices in Cincinnati, Ohio. And I want to acknowledge first with respect, as a non-Native person, that the land on which I stand, live, and work is the traditional territory of the Osage, Shawnee, and Miami peoples, and the Adena and Hopewell cultures. We honor elders past, present, and future, and those who have stewarded this land throughout generations. Today, we have more than 1,400 attendees from 30 states, tuning in from work offices, home offices, living rooms, backyards, and kitchens that are also on the land that was once home to thriving local tribes. Let's take a few minutes to identify the native land where each of you sit today. You should find a link in your chat box that will take you to the Native Land website where you can search your current address. I invite each of you to take a few minutes now, identify the native land you're on today, and then share your name, community, and the native lands in the chat box. I hope you'll bookmark this page and return to it, because it's important that we acknowledge, celebrate, and honor the hundreds of Indigenous nations who continue to live, create, and uphold their sacred relations across their lands. But we must also recognize that our nation, government, academic institutions, and systems were founded upon the exclusion of Indigenous peoples, and that exclusion continues today. Ibram X. Kendi, a leading historian, scholar, and anti-racist voice, debunks the notion that racist policies are created out of ignorance and hate. He explains that, in fact, racist policies are created out of self-interest. And those self-interests are evident as early as this country's founding, when explorers and colonists' drive for wealth and private property overtook the existing Native cultures and communities on the land. This acknowledgement is a reminder of the self-interests that are protecting racist systems today. It's a renewed commitment to dismantle the ongoing legacies of oppression that create and perpetuate inequities. The time is now to build a new nation and a new future. In 1935, Langston Hughes wrote about America. "Let America be America again, the land that never has been yet and yet must be. the land where every man is free. America never was America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be. 85 years later, America has not yet lived up to its own dream. But we're in a moment where we have the power to change the trajectory. Will history books of the future, ones that are more accurate and inclusive, write about the year 2020 as the year that America rewrote its destiny? The year it began to live its stated ideals and values. The year it reimagined systems and communities that were designed for every child and every family to thrive and succeed. Or will it be a chapter of wildfires, pandemics, and protests that concludes with a return to the status quo? We have the power to write that chapter. You have the power to write that chapter. You are writing that chapter as you work with youth and families to respond to COVID-19 and racial injustice. Let me share just a few examples from across our national network. In Minnesota, where one in four English language learners were not engaging in distance learning, Northfield Promise aligned with community-based programs to ensure access and remove language barriers for refugee, immigrant, and Latinx families. They reached more than 80% of ELL students in grades 6 through 12 with regular check-ins, supporting families with food security, social services, and internet access, all in addition to academic support. In Connecticut, Stamford Cradle to Career helped engage nearly 100 partners in a community-wide call to action with specific commitments to advance anti-racist curriculums, policies, and practices. In California, Fresno Cradle to Career spearheaded 3 CARES Act proposals with more than 20 community partners and secured more than $10 million in city and county funding. Their COVID-19 Equity Project and Child Care for Essential Workers initiatives included targeted supports for African American communities, a focus on disabled and vulnerable populations, and outreach in 12 different languages. And in Massachusetts, Boston Opportunity Agenda is working with youth, families, and educators to imagine a future where classrooms have no walls. Let's take a look at what that future will look like.
The reality is that success in school is determined too often by your zip code. Through the pandemic, with all of our schools closed, we realized that we should leverage the power of technology to amplify the work in our public schools in a way that delivers greater equity, access, and opportunity for all young people.
The Campus Without Walls is a remote learning opportunity that is designed to break down the traditional silos of public schools so that students from different schools can take classes together, and so that our students who've been traditionally marginalized and have less access to quality can access that quality online.
We'll be identifying the top teachers across the city. Teachers who can connect with young people, who can deliver real-world project-based learning, who are highly engaging and skillful at culturally and linguistically sustaining and affirming practices. These teachers will open up their classrooms through the power of technology to students all across the city, regardless of the school to which they are assigned.
I'm a mom of 3 children here in Boston, from kindergarten through 12th grade. It's endless, the things that I want them to learn that in a traditional setting just aren't possible. If they hear about a great class online, why shouldn't they be able, you know, to take that class and get credit for it at school? Because learning happens everywhere and all the time.
This is about public education at its best. And so we wanted to hear explicitly from our students, our teachers, our parents, and from the community at large so that we could actually build this Campus Without Walls with input from the actual end users.
We were able to engage 100 young people from 22 of our high schools and do a set of design sprints.
What I like most about distance learning is I have my own time to do my own work, and then I can work at my own pace.
We could improve the structure. There were so many times where classes would just be very unorganized, or teachers wouldn't know how to transfer material.
Just making things more consistent and meaningful for the students to stay motivated, I think, would be very helpful.
We're at an unprecedented moment in history, really the convergence of COVID and the pandemic, combined with a heightened awareness of racial injustice, has everyone ready for change.
Education should actually be something that's so tangible that it aids in the overall success and development and liberation of every family that we serve.
Rather than teaching young people how to navigate a broken system, we need to start taking down that system and reimagining education so it truly is equitable and so that all students have the opportunities that they need and deserve. And that's ultimately what A Campus Without Walls is all about.
These are powerful starts to building a new future. And yet there's always more work to do. Writing history means going beyond incremental change, going beyond tweaks to a system that was built on oppression and for the self-interests of those who were white, wealthy, and male. It means fundamentally reimagining the future. Chalkbeat recently featured students from across the country responding to the Black Lives Matter protests. And Haley Barber, a 16-year-old student from Alabama, exemplified this sentiment in a metaphor. She said, "Don't just trim racism, uproot it." How often do we trim rather than uproot challenges? How often do we take for granted that this is the way things are? Consider for a minute the phenomenon we call summer slide. When students lose some of their learning in reading or math during the 3-month summer break when they aren't using those skills. So we create summer programs and we encourage daily reading. We ask parents to engage in learning activities. We recruit volunteer tutors. But have we ever asked ourselves, what might it look like to not have a summer break? We have the power to change the schedule. This is just one example of many arrangements that we could question. And if 2020 has shown us anything, it's that structures that we have always held as the way things are, can and are being changed. We're social justice advocates and change agents, but how often do we set our sights too low and settle for band-aids instead of transformations? How often do we cater to the interests of the status quo rather than the interests of young people? This network is not made up of individuals who accept the status quo or say it is what it is. You are standing up. You're challenging the way things are, reimagining what's possible. And reimagining what's possible starts with reimagining the model we use to define success and create change with youth and with families. This cross-sector collective impact model was first imagined in 2006, and it's evolved over time. We codified our learnings with our first theory of action back in 2013, and that theory has shifted 4 times since as we continue to test, learn, and adapt how we come together as communities to create better futures. But it is critical that we acknowledge that the origins of the model were rooted in white dominant institutions and cultures, and that our own ways of working require reflection and reimagination. 2 groups in particular are working to redesign our model: the Racial and Ethnic Equity Action Team and the Co-Development of Solutions Fellowship. 27 network members, community partners, and StriveTogether staff are collaborating as part of the Racial and Ethnic Equity Action Team. And in March, they published StriveTogether's Racial Equity Statement. In it, they've included a vision of equitable and just communities. And I'd like to invite a few members of that team to introduce the vision now.
Hi, I'm Vanessa Lyles, the co-project director of PT Partners in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and partner of Bridgeport Prosper. And in our vision, youth are at the center of all systems that shape opportunity in their community.
Hi, I'm Sonia Littledeer-Evans, the Deputy Director of Deschutes County Juvenile Community Justice in Bend, Oregon, and partner of Better Together Central Oregon. And in our vision, Black, Indigenous, Latinx, and people of color are heard, valued, and elevated for their power and their authority.
Hi, I'm Zalia Kimbrell, the Director of Research and Analytics at Impact Tulsa in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And in our vision, youth voice, community wisdom, and community assets are centered in decision-making processes.
Hello, I'm Megan Lowry, Director of the Stanislaus Cradle to Career Partnership in Stanislaus County, California. And in our vision, our frameworks, approaches, and shared outcomes are guided by our understanding of equity.
Hi, I'm Matt Snyder, the Data Director at Higher Expectations for Racine County in Racine, Wisconsin. And in our vision, leaders have a deeper understanding of equity and our role in creating change.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Sines, Senior Director of Strategic Initiatives and Continuous Improvement with E3 Alliance in Austin, Texas. And in our vision, the racial and ethnic composition of staff, particularly leadership, represents their community.
Hi, I'm Letitia Vaughn, the Chief Operating Officer of Tri-County Cradle to Career in Charleston, South Carolina. And in our vision, policies are adopted and amended to create better opportunities and outcomes for youth and families.
Hi, I'm Balpreet Gore, the Manager of People, Values, and Culture at StriveTogether in Cincinnati, Ohio. And in our vision, restorative practices are in place to repair harm and restore relationships.
Vision a reality in your communities and in your network. Since releasing the statement, the Racial and Ethnic Equity Action Team has been developing new ways to measure how systems, structures, and institutions have changed to address inequities. And they're actively envisioning a bold and equitable education model. Meanwhile, 10 communities are digging deeper into how youth and community are centered within systems in our co-development of Solutions Fellowship. They're envisioning what true shared community vision and collaborative action will look like when it's inclusive of youth and families to build a better future together. It isn't enough to have more Black and Brown faces in your boardrooms or your change networks. It isn't enough to have a young scholar at the table. Authentic co-design with community requires us to change mindsets about who can create solutions and whose expertise is valued. It requires us to build relationships and trust, to follow through on our commitments, and to acknowledge and heal previous harms. And it requires us to let go of some of our agendas in service of the community's vision, to share decision-making and yield power. Okay, I want you to take a moment to envision a new future for your own community. This is a future that prioritizes equity, that centers youth in the redesign of systems and their education, where leaders, change networks, and boards are representative of the community, where policies upend systemic racism, where Black, Latinx, Indigenous, and Asian-led movements hold resources and decision-making power, where organizations and systems are accountable to the visions of community rather than grant deliverables or antiquated policies. We hold so many existing structures and arrangements as the way things are, but we can transform the way things are if we can imagine it and if we use our collective power to build it. Nevertheless, we must acknowledge that transformation takes time. Transformation requires persistence and tenacity. This is evident as we look at issues such as voting rights. In 46 short days, citizens will cast their ballot, selecting new local, state, and national leaders or affirming those in office, and voting on key measures that impact their daily lives. It's been 150 years since the 15th Amendment, which declared that the right to vote would not be denied based on the color of one's skin. And it's been 55 years since the Voting Rights Act outlawed discriminatory practices such as poll taxes and literacy tests. And yet, this year, voting rights activists are still fighting against tactics such as voter purges, racial gerrymandering, closed polling locations, restrictions on vote by mail or early voting, and voter intimidation that still prevents Black, Latinx, and other marginalized communities' voices from being counted in our elections. The baton is passed from generation to generation, from John Lewis to Stacey Abrams, to perhaps a young leader in our network today, each taking up their power to advance justice. This network has that tenacity and persistence. We are taking up our power to advance justice and build a better future. Because in the words of the late Congressman John Lewis, if not us, who? And if not now, when? But this long journey will require that we take care of ourselves and our communities along the way. And it will require that we have a powerful group of changemakers disrupting the status quo alongside us. The one thing that has not changed since this movement first began is that we can do more together than we can apart. In 2020, we've made significant progress in expanding our national partnerships with other social change organizations who are committed to equity and the success of every child cradle to career. This is critical in growing the movement, creating momentum for change, joining forces not only locally or within our national network, but with many, many other national movements who share common visions and goals. Working with Blue Meridian Partners through their Power of Place initiative, we're partnering with PolicyLink and Results for America to identify policy priorities that advance place-based work. Together with partners like Community Solutions and Enterprise, we're looking very closely at the intersection of housing and education. And in an unprecedented demonstration of national alignment and modeling after one of our own network members, UP Partnership in San Antonio, more than 20 national organizations and networks joined StriveTogether in signing a national equitable recovery pledge, committing to working together to create more resilient systems and communities as our country emerges from the crises that we're facing. We also have an emerging and crucial partnership with the Harlem Children's Zone and their new national venture, the William Julius Wilson Institute. Harlem Children's Zone started in the 90s with a goal of serving a neighborhood comprehensively. And they created a pipeline of seamless and coordinated supports from birth through college and built community and an environment where children can thrive. The one block pilot expanded to 24 and then to 60 and now 97 blocks serving 14,000 youth and 14,000 adults in the zone. It demonstrates for me the power of place. Each of our network member partnerships have a clearly defined geographic scope, ranging from individual neighborhoods to entire metro areas to 27 or more counties, and now statewide coalitions. Citywide, countywide, statewide efforts are all critical to transforming funding, policies, and systems at scale. However, neighborhood or place-based initiatives hold particular advantages to impacting change. Here today to talk about the power of place is none other than the founder and president of the Harlem Children's Zone, Geoffrey Canada. My dear friend Jeff is an icon in his own right. He has dedicated the last three decades to what the New York Times has called one of the most ambitious social policy experiments of our time. Thanks to Jeff's visionary leadership, Harlem Children's Zone has become an incredible national model and one that our network has been learning from for years. With this new partnership with HCZ and the William Julius Wilson Institute, we believe that together we can truly spread and scale the principles of place-based cradle to career work across the country. Jeff, we are so honored that you could be here with us today.
So, Jennifer, thank you for that wonderful introduction. I can't tell you how excited I am to be joining all of the StriveTogether networks on this inaugural kickoff for me, but what you all have been doing for some years. And I am extremely excited about this partnership. As Jennifer will tell you, as soon as she called and said, Jeff, would you consider, I said, yes, yes, right away. Why? Because this is a particularly interesting, important, and critical time in this country. And I feel the need to reach out to people who are true believers in equity, to say, we have to come together and we have to do something different. So Jennifer, your call was really terrific. By the way, I'm here in Harlem. I'm at our main office. This is actually my office that we're in, kind of made it look nice. I got all dressed up for you today. I just want to hope everybody appreciates that. This is my typical attire when I'm going out to do battle. I've been fighting for children in this country for more than 45 years. And everybody who knows me knows Jeff is in a jacket and tie, and I am off to do battle. So I dressed for battle today because I think we have some real work to do. But you know, every time I come to my office, I just, you can't see it, but I have all my stuff around. And after 45 years, you collect a bunch of stuff. I feel like this has been a place where all kinds of interesting things have happened. Jennifer, I took your call, but I've had some wonderful calls that have happened to me at the Harlem Children's Zone. More than 20 years ago, I was really, before the zone was created, I was trying to figure out how to do the zone, you know, and I was kind of feeling myself. And I remember I having these meetings and I'd get these people together and I told our receptionist, look, when I'm meeting, I don't want to be disturbed. Wait for my meetings to end before interrupting me with telephone calls. She said, okay, Jeff, okay, fine. So I come out of my meeting and she hands me a slip of paper. And on the paper, it said, the White House. I said, excuse me, what do you mean? She said, oh, the White House call. I said, well, what do you mean the White House call? She said, the White House call. I said, well, what did you tell them? I told them you were in a meeting and you couldn't be disturbed. I said, you didn't tell the White House that? Yes, she did. I thought, okay. I never thought I had to say, there's some people maybe you can interrupt me for. I've had another sort of interesting call. A person called and my first said, oh, Jeff, there's someone on the phone for you. I get on the phone. The person says, whom do I have the pleasure of speaking to? And I was like, what are you talking about? You called me. Why? But you know, you have to be cool. I said, this is Jeff Canada. And he was like, oh, I'm calling on behalf of His Majesty. I was like, His Majesty? What? Prince Charles. Prince Charles came, was here in my office. Prince Charles came. That's a whole story. I'll tell you that story some other time. But probably one of the coolest calls I've gotten it wasn't actually in my office. I was driving to work. Phone rang. I didn't see the, recognize the number, the Chicago number. I picked up the phone and it said, Jeff. I said, yes. Oprah. And I was like, Oprah, it's Oprah. But then you have, hi, Oprah, this is Jeff. Right? I'm trying to be really cool, but you know what I'm saying. How did Oprah A get my number? And why is she calling me? So you live and you do this work a long time, you're going to have some interesting conversations. But one of the most important conversations I've had recently was Jennifer, her team at StriveTogether. Our team here at the William Julius Wilson Institute in the Harlem Children's Zone, deciding that we were going to come together to do something that has not been done in this country before. And this brought me out of retirement. I was happily retired, right? Kwame is the CEO, he's running the shop, that was great. But there is some unfinished work in this country that we have to tackle. And that work is for us to go out and save the children in this country. And I am convinced we now have the kind of troops it's going to take to get this job done. I'm here with you, hoping that together we can rewrite history moving forward for today. So now I'm going to say something. I talked to my wife Yvonne about that this morning, and she said, I don't know about that, Jeff. You may not want to go down that road. I'm going to go down the road anyhow, because I happen to believe it's true. Now, you're going to get this if you watch Game of Thrones. Now, if you didn't watch Game of Thrones, okay, I'm going to give you the cliff note versions of this. But part of the message I have today is that winter is coming. All right, so for those of you who don't know Game of Thrones, you know, all these kingdoms, they all fight one another. Everybody hate one another. Everybody is trying to undercut one another, kind of like social services are today. Right? Everybody's competing. These ones are talking about those ones. They're talking about this. Meanwhile, there's a plague that's coming that's going to destroy everybody. While all the humans are fighting one another, this plague is coming, and a prophet is telling them winter is coming. And they didn't understand, because the plague, it really operated in the cold, and that's when it was coming, and people kept missing the point of this thing. Winter is coming. We have gone through a horrible period in the last 6 months of this country. We've lost close to 200,000 people who have died, and millions of Americans who have been sick and who have suffered. Our communities, the Strive Together communities, the Harlem Children's Zone, people doing this work like us around the country, our communities are being devastated by this thing. These are the places where people have lost their jobs. They can't pay their rent. They don't know how they're going to feed their children. And worse, the schools are not functioning in these places, and inequality is being continued on for the next generation right in front of our eyes. And yet, what I'm hearing is that the next 3 to 4 months, we can potentially have another 200 million Americans die from COVID-19 because this thing is waiting on the cold. Winter is coming, and it is going to kill a whole bunch of our families if we don't act. So, look, I've been home like everybody. I've been trying to stay safe. I've been trying to make sure that my family is safe. We've all been working remotely, but I am telling you, those of us who care about the children in this country, we're gonna have to do something right now to save our communities, because this thing is not a joke. And when they're talking about 200,000, who do you think they're talking about? They're not talking about the folks who live on Park Avenue. They're not talking about the folks who have the money and will be just fine, and their children will be fine. They're talking about the people in our communities. Now, I'm no prophet, but I am telling you, it is time for us to come together and make a decision that we are not going to be the ones that have our families destroyed by this. Look, our work was hard enough before COVID. This was never easy. Coming in, intentionally going into the most distressed communities to help the children and families, that was never easy. Now we're faced with something that is significantly more difficult. And I'm gonna say this, and I hope no one takes this personal. This is a time for folks who are leaders to have courage and be prepared to step up and put your principles up front and say, I am going to do everything humanly possible to save the children and families in my community. And so we've got to do some things differently. This leadership, I mean, this is a leadership call. This is not for everybody. And if you say, you know what, Jeff, I hear you. This is not my thing, right? And that's fine. I'm not mad at you. Everybody can't step in and do this work moving forward. It is not for everybody. It never has been. But some of us have to stand up and say, not my community. I'm not going without a fight. I'm going to make sure I do everything humanly possible to save my children and my family. So when this plague is over, we can begin to rebuild our communities again. We can make sure these kids have a real opportunity to be successful. So what are some of the things we have to do? First of all, we have to be prepared to look at the data, to be honest about what's working and what's not. Because I'll tell you, this data thing is real. And when you, if you come from a place like Harlem and you work in a place like this and you look at the data is not good. And there's no reason, don't try and dress it up. Don't try and pretend that, you know what, things are better than they are. No, they are not. They are bad. We're going to acknowledge that and we're going to try to fix it. Here's the other thing. Fixing it is not easy. And what I have seen over and over again is people work really hard. They give it everything they got and that data doesn't change. And instead of confronting that, they try to come up with excuses why we shouldn't treat the data as if it's real. My thing is, when the data is bad, admit the data is bad. Acknowledge that we have to now act differently if we're going to improve that data. You know, when Paul Tufts wrote his book about our work, Whatever It Takes, there's a section in there where he thanks me for calling him in because the worst programmatic moment of my entire life happened right in the middle of Paul writing that book. And we had just started our middle school, and I had promised my kids that I was going to keep them in our schools until they graduate high school and they went to college. But our middle school was doing so poorly that there was no reason to start a high school when we didn't even have the middle school together. And so the toughest decision I ever made was to close the high school before it opened. And I was going to tell my parents and my students, they didn't know this was happening, that after I had promised them, I stood in front of them and I said, I promise you, you can stay with me until you graduate high school and go to college. We're going to help you get through college. So the day I was going to meet with my parents, I asked Paul Tuff to come in and write about that day. And Paul acknowledges who would call a newspaper reporter on the worst day of their career. And there's a reason I did that. I knew that in the end, hard work, dealing with the data, rebuilding the team, we would end up being successful. But I also knew that people have an idea of romanticizing this work. Like, oh yeah, Jeff never messed up. He never had a hard time. He never failed at anything. Yes, I had failed and I had failed miserably and I had failed publicly and I was humiliated and I wanted the world to know that did not stop me. We fixed those problems. We confronted those facts. We, at our school now, we've eliminated the achievement gap between Black and white students. But I wanted the field to understand this work is hard. You try really hard and sometimes it does not work. And don't make excuses. Fix the problem. Build the team it takes to fix the problem. Well, here's the next thing I think we have to confront. That in the end, we've got to make sure that we're prepared to ask for help. I don't know why in our business, people feel like if you have to call and ask for some help, somehow that's like a stain against you. And it's funny because the longer I've been in the field, when we were small and I could see everything, I could walk around and I could see all the teachers, all the students, and I could tell how things were going. But as we built this organization, the larger it became, the less I actually knew of what was going on. Right, because now I'm not in one place. We got 15 places. I can't be in 15 places. I'm doing all management. So when I would call my team together, I would ask them, how's it going? You know what they would tell me? Fine. Early childhood, how's it going? Oh, it's going fine. Middle school, it's going, oh, Jeff, it's great. How about high school? Oh, no, high school's going good. Now, wait a second. At that time, we had 12,000 kids. I know if you're working with 10 kids, it ain't going good. There's going to be issues. How could you tell me if I got 12,000 kids, it's all going good? You know why? Because people don't want to come in and admit that they're struggling, that they're having problems, that things are not going good. But guess what I'm the best at? I'm the best at fixing problems. But if you don't tell me there is a problem, I can't fix the problem. But I will find the problem. And then we're going to have a problem because you didn't come bring it to me. What is that in our field that people are so worried about coming in and asking for help, saying this is not working, I need support. Can you help me with this? Can you help me with that? That is something, if we are going to do this work, that is something we're going to have to confront up front. We all need help. Here at the Harlem Tool Zone, we've been doing this 20 years. I'm still learning every day. I'm finding great programs. I'm hearing what people are doing and saying, wow, that's great. We should be doing that in the zone. What's wrong with that? Look, winter is coming. We're going to be serious about it. We're going to have to come together. We're going to have to share all of our resources. We're going to have to decide that this is going to be a team effort, and this is all hands on deck if we're going to do the right job. Now, let me say the last thing that I want to say about this particular set of challenges we face. You know, I talk about some of the celebrity stuff, and yeah, you know, I've been lucky enough to have, you know, in the documentaries and the books and the other things. But here's the thing you have to know. This is life or death for our families. Poverty, I know all too well about poverty. I know what it does. I know how it destroys not just families, but communities. And when, you know, we had done the documentary Waiting for Superman. For a long time, it didn't have a title. And once it was going on, no title. And then one day, Davis Guggenheim, the producer, called me and said, Jeff, I know what we're going to call the documentary. I said, what? He said, Waiting for Superman. And I was shocked because that was taken from in the documentary, a story I told, which was true, that when I was young, 7 or 8, I was a big comic book fan, right? Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman. Sorry, there was no Marvel, no Spider-Man. But I'm old, so y'all have to excuse that. And when my mother told me there was no Superman, I began to cry. And she thought I was crying because there was no Easter Bunny, right? Like, oh, yeah. I wasn't crying because of that. I was crying because if there was no superheroes, growing up in the South Bronx in the late 50s and the early 60s, while that place was falling apart, while violence was on the rise, while it was chaos, there were drugs everywhere, kids were getting no education. I knew if there were no superheroes, we weren't gonna make it. We weren't gonna get out of there. And I was right. And you say, well, Jeff, you got out. Yeah, I got out. But you know, I had 3 other brothers. 2 of them got out, 1 never made it past 21. My wife was from Harlem. She had 3 other brothers and sisters. None of them made it out. This thing we're talking about is life or death. And I'm gonna tell you something even scarier. Where I grew up in the South Bronx, I'm the only one left of the boys that I knew when I played with. They're all gone. Some died in their teens, some in their 20s, some in their 30s, some in their 40s. They're all gone. We need people who are serious and want to stand up. We need people who want to stand up, want to fight for these children. We need to come together and say, you know what? We can fix this thing in the United States if we come together and we harness the resources and we get this work done. And that's what we're going to be doing with you all, trying to make sure there are the resources necessary, because it takes money. There's no getting around that. And we're working on a plan now for $100 billion. We want the federal government to invest in communities around this country that are these same communities that have been underinvested in for more than 100 years. Let's get this done. Let's do this. Now, I want to close today. I'm sorry. I know I started yelling at you. My wife was like, Jeff, don't go down that thing, because then you're going to get all crazy. But you know what? This is real. This is serious. And we've got to take it serious. So let me, I want to close with a poem. I like to close my talks with poetry that I've written. And this particular poem is called Take a Stand. And it's because if we don't fight for our children, if we're not prepared to take some risk, if we're not prepared to stand up and be courageous and be leaders and do some innovative things, then our families are not going to make it. And so we've got to take a stand and do whatever's necessary in the political realm, in the human service realm, in the education realm, to save our communities. So let me close with Take a Stand. Maybe before we didn't know that Corey is afraid to go to school, the store, to roller skate. He cries a lot for a boy of 8. But now we know each day it's true that other girls and boys cry too. They cry for us to lend a hand. Time for us to take a stand. And little Maria's window screens keeps out flies and other things. But she knows to duck her head when she prays each night for bed. Because in the window come some things that shatter little children's dreams. For some, the hourglass is out of sync. Time for us to take a stand. And Charlie's deepest secret wishes is someone to smother him with kisses and squeeze and hug him tight, so tight, while he pretends to put up a fight. Or at least someone to be at home who misses him. He's so alone. Who allowed this child's forsaken land? Look in the mirror. Take a stand. And on the Sabbath, when we pray to our God, we often say, O Jesus, Muhammad, Abraham, I come to better understand how to learn to love and give and lead the life you taught to live. In faith, we must join hand in hand. Suffer the children, take a stand. And tonight, some child will go to bed, no food, no place to lay their head, no hand to hold, no lap to sit, to give slobbery kisses from slobbery lips. So you and I, we must succeed in this crusade, this holy deed, to say to the children of this land, have hope, we're here, we take a stand. Thank you very much. Let's take a stand and let's stand together.
Wow, Jeff, amazing. I am, thank you so much. I can think of no one better to kick off our 11th annual convening. As you were talking, I was thinking about back in 2010, when we were doing the work here on the ground in Cincinnati as part of the Strive partnership. We held watch parties for the work to really look at the Waiting for Superman video, to kind of really talk through with the community about what that would, you know, look like in our community. And here we are coming together to take a stand together. And so it's just really amazing to be here with you. And thank you for your remarks, your inspiration, and for taking this time with me today to be able to just have this conversation. So really looking forward to this conversation. And if you're ready, we'll start with some questions.
I think we got the technical situation under control now. And I'm ready. I'm happy to take some questions.
Good, wonderful, Jeff. Now I can see you. Now I feel much better, right? Good. So Jeff, first and foremost, what I wanted to say while I was waiting to figure out what was going on here is that I'm so honored to take a stand with you. And as we think about that, one of the questions that was coming in to from our audience is really how do you think that regional partnerships, like the type of work that we do through our Strive Together Cradle to Career Network, can really partner and support and complement and collaborate with neighborhood partnerships? I mean, this is clearly what you and I have been talking about a lot with our teams, but would love to hear your perspective on what this can look like on the ground in communities, because it feels like there's nothing more important right now.
Well, Jennifer, I couldn't agree with you more. And I think you know how I feel about the need for us to be able to work across from neighborhood into region and to work collaboratively at the same time. But I want to say something, which is that I think the work that Strive Together, all of you all, are doing around this country is some of the most important work going on in America today. And we've got to make sure that we support it, which we want to do, and that we're partners in it. So here's what I think just about what we need to do. We need to get better at having the kind of communications that say, first of all, let me tell you what I'm doing and what I'm struggling with, and let me understand more of what you're doing and what you're struggling with. And while we can't help one another with everything, we should be able to help one another with some things. There has to be a value proposition, right? I have to see something, because look, we're all working so hard, right? That I need to feel like, you know what, this is gonna help me actually do my job better. And I have a partner out there who's willing to help me. So part of it is, I think we have to have some different conversations. We gotta forget the past, right? There's all kinds of drama that's happened in all communities, and people are still mad about something happened in 1993, and they won't let it go. And we gotta put the children and families first and say, okay, that happened. How do we move forward from this point on so that we can work in cooperation? And I think honest answers, I can help you with that, but I can't help you with this. I think that's a starting place. And then it'll build. The other thing I want to say, Jennifer, is that the thing that you have with this network is you have the ability for folks to try some things and then to share it and see what's working across other parts of the network. And I think that kind of learning is invaluable.
Thank you. Yeah, I could not agree with you more. We call it the network effect. And it's really, and we're thrilled to have more promised neighborhoods engaged in the network and learning from the neighborhood work. And just as you said, I think what we've learned in our conversations with our team at Strive Together and the team at Harlem Children's Zone and the William Julius Wilson Institute is that we just have to be honest and transparent and figure out how to work together. And that's no more important, that's the most important thing we can do now, because as you said, and you can tell your wife, I feel like the Game of Thrones reference really worked. So let Yvonne know. Worked well, and winter. I mean, winter is coming. We're in the midst of three pandemics, four pandemics, you know, with COVID-19, with continued racial injustice, and the economic downturn. What we're facing, as you so aptly described it, are sort of a rush of immediate problems, immediate issues, as well as longer term systemic. And so, one of the questions I would love to hear from you is, or one of the things we'd love to talk about is really how do you balance the immediate needs. Yep. Given these crises with the longer term systemic changes that need to be made?
So here, I think we have to have a bifurcated way of thinking about this work, because the most important thing is to save as many of our children and families as possible in every way possible. And that means right now, that means how do we protect them? How do we help them figure out how they're gonna make ends meet? At the same time, we've gotta be thinking, this is going to end, And we have to be able to pick up in a hurry and move forward. And it's not necessarily the same people doing both things. One of the things I think we have to do in our organizations is say, who's going to deal with the immediate emergency right now? And we shouldn't take our eye off of this. This is the job one, is to save as many of our children and families and our communities as we can. But at the same time saying, look, all of us can't be doing that. Some of us have to be thinking about what's the next steps. How do we actually bring some real lasting political policy, economic change in our communities? Let me tell you what I think the answer to, well, we don't have enough staff to do all of that, is that we got to do it together. We got to share information so that if I'm trying to figure out some way of helping during a flu epidemic, I want to be able to share that with everybody so everybody doesn't have to reinvent the same thing. Let's find the best practice. If I'm thinking that, you know what, the most important thing for me is to finish out my cradle to career and I need some help in these areas, let's come together and help one another think that through. I think we can do that. And I think we have to do both things at the same time. Priority number one, save as many children and families as we can. But let's also think about how we put resources so that we don't stop and have to then gear up and start from zero.
Absolutely. So the way StriveTogether defines systems transformation and sort of that long-term work is shifting power, policies, resources, and practices. And I think, you know, we've talked about there's so much alignment in sort of how we approach this work in our respective organizations. But the theme of this convening is really the power of you. And it's about doing work and shifting and sharing power with young people and families and communities. So talk a little bit about what that looks like, particularly on the ground in neighborhood work.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things we have to do right now is we have to reestablish communication. Everybody's been locked down. I mean, when the last time any of us have been close to enough to anybody for them to, breathe on us. We have sort of pushed everybody away. And some of us have gotten really used to using these remote ways of communicating. A lot of our families haven't. This is still not a secondary way for them to think about processing information and other things. And so we've got to reestablish communication with our family. And we've got to try to figure out and understand where are they at right now, because we have some sense of where they were. But I am telling you, from everything I'm seeing, there's no help coming from the federal government. They're not coming in with any more resources. People who are unemployed, they're not going to be able to get the money. We're holding off evictions till January, but no one knows what's going to happen after that. The food lines were already unbelievably long before they decided they weren't going to increase the unemployment money. We need to be able to figure out from our families, how can we help you right now? And I don't want to have the wrong conversation. I don't want to be talking to you, right, about you joining the PTA, and what you really want to talk about is, guess what? I don't have any food, and I don't know how I'm going to feed my kids tomorrow. We need to start where the residents in our communities are right now and be there with them, because that's how we're going to build the trust. Because you know what people are going to think, Jennifer? When I was going through that, where were you? How come you didn't come? How come nobody raised their hand and said, I'll help you get through this? So now you want to come to me after and ask me to do this and that. We need to begin to lean in right now where they are, so they know where they're, because look, we're all isolated. We've all been away and we all have felt somewhat marginalized in this process. We've got to go and start reaching out and rebuilding this communication with families right now.
Absolutely. I mean, and that's one of the things that excites me the most about the partnership that we're engaged in together, because this is where our network can really learn from the work on the ground. There are many, many places where we can learn from your work, but just thinking about when you called up to see about partnering with the Audacious Project, and my initial reaction was like, well, Jeff, you know, our work is at the systems level. It's at the network level. I'm trying to figure out how we do this together. And very quickly, we were able, you know, in talking with many of our partnerships, this is the where they want to go. This is where we need to go. If we're talking about measuring how to shift power in communities, we have to get on the ground with residents, with community, and no one does that better than the Harlem Children's Zone and the Promise Neighborhoods. And so really excited about the opportunities for partnership in communities in that work. And as we've talked, you and I have talked, we just need to do some work together in communities, do actual work, not talk about business level. Let's do some work on the ground. Take a stand.
I couldn't agree with you more, and it's the key. And you know, the biggest mistake that was made, in my opinion, in the charter school movement is that folks thought you could help families without explaining or talking or interacting with them. And guess what? Folks felt like, who are you? Why are you doing this? I'm doing it for you. No. I don't believe that. So part of what I think is that those of us who are engaged in this work at all of the levels, all of the systems, we have to build an understanding of what we're doing and why, so that when we need our families, they're there and they understand what we're doing, working with them on their behalf. And I just think that we've got to take more time spending having this conversation up and down, you know, at the very highest levels. We're talking to a group of leaders and trying to influence. We need to make sure that conversation is happening also at the neighbor. Same conversation happening at the neighborhood level, saying, hey, you know what this thing should look like? So that when there's an opportunity to have a community-wide discussion, both sides feel equally informed.
Absolutely. And you know, we have many community members in the audience today. And so when you think of, you know, you've been doing this for a while now, and, you know, what advice would you give to those community change makers who are trying to figure out how to engage and really, you know, would benefit from what you've learned? And you also shared in your talk a little bit about fail forwards, which we love in this network. So what advice do you have to give to those in the community who are just getting started in this work and wanting to really change and transform systems as you have?
Well, first thing, this is probably not what people would think I was going to say. You have to take care of yourself. You have to take care of yourself. I mean, we all have been through something that none of us have ever been through before. And it's taken a toll. And it's taken a toll on some of us physically, and some of us emotionally, and some of us spiritually. And if, I think we all have a well that we draw on every day when you're doing this work, right? You go out, you're giving it, and it's tough work, it's hard, it's demanding, and it's wearing you down. And then you go home and you replenish that well, and you get up the next day and you're like, well, that well has been drawn on now for months in ways it's never happened before. And we need to first take care of ourselves. We need to get back in touch and make sure that we are spiritually healthy, emotionally healthy, physically healthy, because this is, you can't come and give me 3 months and then burn out. That's not what this thing is. This is a long haul, which means folks have to be in this and able to do this for us. So that's the first thing. Take care of yourself. Here's the second thing, probably not what people are gonna think. Take care of your family. If your family is suffering, you're not going to be able to focus on anything else. That's going to be, so we got to take care of home that allows us to have the ability then to focus on the work of community and the building that's out there. So a lot of folks, they come at this work and they get so ripped up and then you look and a year later, they're worn out. They didn't take care of themselves. And you know what? I think if you start with yourself, you're going to be much more likely to be able to stay for the long haul. Here's the other thing I would say just to that question. Look for answers in places that you haven't already looked. I'm always amazed. There's so many good things going on out there, and there are so many people who are reinventing the wheel. They're trying to figure it out on their own. They want to be the ones to say, you know what, I did this, I figured this out. You don't have to figure it out. Other people have spent years and decades trying to figure this stuff out. Find the best stuff, translate it for your own community, because you can't just import things that maybe work somewhere else, but spend the time doing the research. I tell folks, you know, a lot of people go to school, they learn all these research skills, and the moment they graduate, they never use them again, right? It's like, yeah, I passed the test. No, this is the test. The test is, can you research now and take that knowledge and use it to propel your work forward?
Great, great advice. And I mean, you know, I so appreciate, I honestly didn't expect you to start with self-care and family care. And I'm so glad that you did. It is, you know, you mentioned in your talk that this work was really hard pre-COVID, and it's even harder now when those of us who do this work are taking care of family members, of trying to support our children's learning at home, and you know, all across communities, just really, really trying to make this, all of these things work right now. So the importance of self-care and family care is not lost on us. And, you know, there's programming next week as part of the convening, but I was thinking going into this virtual setting, you know, one of the things that we look forward to every year is this time to come together as community change makers to be able to rejuvenate, to get strength and get sort of recharged from one another. And we're not able to do that right now, but I'm sure it's happening in the Zoom chat that I cannot see right now. I know you all are connecting with one another, but really appreciate you leading with those examples and that advice, Jeff, because it is the most critical thing that we can do in this work right now. Last question. And it's a big one. I heard you say earlier in one of your answers, you know, that the federal government isn't going to come to our rescue right now. And I think we all know that current state. But as someone who gets calls from the White House, who has advised policymakers and helped to create some of the most incredible policy that has supported this work, what advice would you give to policymakers right now as you think about the policy that needs to be developed to support this work? And I ask that question because I have hope that there is going to be change. I think that we all have to have that hope. So what is the advice you would give to policymakers right now?
And there are two, that's a great question. And there are two answers to this. One is, I think a lot of the answer is gonna happen after January. I just think during this period right now, that we're not going to see folks putting poor Americans first, and that's a problem. So here's what I would say to policymakers. They have demonstrated to the American people that when they care about a problem, they are willing to spend trillions of dollars of money that they do not have. And they have done so. They have done so for businesses, right? They have done so to help unemployed Americans. And this idea that there is not money to go into the most devastated places in our country and get organizations that have demonstrated effectiveness, the resources to do their job, is just a lie. It is not true. They have demonstrated when the country cares about something, they will invest the money. So any policymaker that starts with, I'm sorry, we can't afford it, I just don't want to hear that because it's not true. If you value poor people in this country, then you can absolutely afford it, which is why working with PolicyLink, we're calling for this $100 billion targeting the 100 most devastated communities. The country can afford that. That is not something that they're going to say, oh, that's going to break the budget, or we can't do that. And here's the other problem. Folks will come and say, okay, well, we made investments in these places. What Raj Chetty's work, who's the economist from Harvard, who has done all this place-based work. What his work shows is that, yeah, you may help certain areas, but there are always these certain places in community that resist any of those sort of global chance investments. They remain places where children don't have social and economic mobility. These places have to be targeted specifically, because you know why? In your talk earlier, Jennifer, you talked about the legacy of racism in this country. These places were targeted intentionally to be disinvested in. And so we have to now target them intentionally to reinvest in them. And you can't just say, well, you know what? I'm going to give more money to Head Start and that's going to help. No, we need to target the most vulnerable communities specifically and still give more money to Head Start. But these places need a different level of investment, because whether they need Cradle to Career, they need that, as well as all of the policy work that has to go on to try and rework these systems, which have intentionally in some cases, and sometimes just historically, undermined the success of children and families in these places, which we know we have to work on all of these systems at the same time.
Absolutely. We have our work cut out for us. As you've said, we are absolutely in this together. We are in it to take a stand for children and families across the country, and very, very excited and honored to be in partnership as StriveTogether, in partnership with Harlem Children's Zone and the William Julius Wilson Institute, and so grateful to you for your continued leadership. Also, I think I heard maybe Yvonne was on, so Yvonne, thank you for letting Jeff come out of retirement to continue to lead in what is the most important time in our country that we have to lead on really transforming systems for young people and families across the United States. So with that, Jeff, just grateful to you for being with us today to kick things off, and wishing you and the team at HCZ and the Wilson Institute the continued health and continued wellness, and look forward to seeing you on the next Zoom probably in a few days.
Sure will. Look forward to working with you. Go forward, strive together. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.